Good evening. It's good to see everyone here. If you take a hymn book and turn to hymn number 138, number 138, O Come All Ye Faithful. Good crowd tonight. That's always good to see. Norman, if you'd open us in a word of prayer, we'll sing, O Come All Ye Faithful. Hymn number 138, O Come All Ye Faithful. Another little music lesson tonight. Whenever you're calling somebody, I know Becky will say, Jimmy, you know what? I never hear her. You know what she does the second time? What would she do? Raise her voice. Jimmy! You know what? A lot of times I still don't hear. But the third time, she knows what she's got to do because I'm making noise or something. This chorus is calling three times, O come, let us adore him. So you start out soft, and then you build, and then you build. So let's have a good time singing when we get to the chorus on the third verse. Yea, Lord, we greet thee, born this happy morning. Jesus, to thee be all glory give. Word of the Father, now appearing. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Christ the Lord. Excellent, excellent. Now, the next time we sing it, y'all will remember that, and we'll do it again that way. Hymn number 135, Hark the Herald Angels Sing, number 135. Rise.
Acts chapter.
That song is absolutely full of theology. The guy that wrote it knew some theology, or he wouldn't be able to write things like that. Acts chapter number 12. Of course, last time that's been 2 weeks ago now, because last week was the Pie and Praise. But we started this chapter, which we called the Sanction Persecution. And we started with the persecution by Herod, and I will not, for the sake of time, go back and review all of that. But we're going to see two other things. We'll finish up the first one tonight, and we might get into the second one, the pride of Herod. Then we'll finish up with the progress of the ministry at the end of the chapter. But we finished up last time in verse number 7 through 12, looking at what we called the intervention of the Lord. And when we read something like this, we need to remind ourselves that this is not a story. It's history. There's a big difference between the two. And when we see something supernatural take place like this, it's not magic. It's the power of God. And God intervened, of course. And it's sort of interesting, as you study this chapter, it starts off, of course, Herod is king. He's killed James. He's put Peter in prison. And the chapter ends with Peter free and Herod dead. And a big swing, right? And just because a man is powerful on the face of the earth does not mean, of course, that he has power to keep himself in that position. Again, all that's in the Lord's hands. And tonight I want to go back to verse number 12. We'll pick up tonight with what we call the interrupted prayer meeting, verse number 12. And when he had considered, of course, Peter again considered, and when he really came to himself after being awakened and experiencing what he experienced, he finally, when he got out, he stopped and said, "Hey, this is real. This took place." When he considered the thing, he came to the house of Mary, the mother of John, whose surname was Mark, where many were gathered together praying. And of course, here, the first thing we see in this interrupted prayer meeting is the place that Peter sought. He went to a very familiar place, a place that had an outer court big enough for inside the house was big enough for a number of people to be there praying. It has been suggested by a number of writers that this is where the upper room was, where the Lord instituted the Lord's table. But nonetheless, Peter went to a place close to the prison, I think, a place that he knew would be praying, a place, I think, one of many around the city where the church was praying for Peter. But when you're in need, where do you seek? Who do you seek? I mean, when problems arise, we should seek right here. I mean, we should seek this body right here. I mean, we should seek our brothers and sisters in Christ. And the local church is a body. It's the body of Christ. And if when you need help, that's where you need to be going. You can't go to the lost world and expect to get help, spiritual help in the time of need. You go to people that you know love you. And isn't it nice to have people that love you? People that you know is going to pray for you when things are difficult, and we all will have difficult times because of where we live. We live in a sin-cursed world. But having brothers and sisters, a place to seek, and here we find that. Notice verse number 13. And as Peter knocked at the door of the gate, again the outer gate, a damsel came to hearken named Rhoda. The first thing we saw was the place he sought. The second thing we see is the person of excitement. I call her this because she gets excited. By the way, there's nothing wrong with excitement. I know a lot of people major on excitement. If they don't have excitement, they don't feel like they've been to church, so therefore they seek out a church where they sort of swing from the chandeliers and, you know, scream and holler and that type of thing. By the way, you can find churches like that. They're a little bit everywhere. But every church, by the way, I was raised in a church like that. The first independent Baptist church I ever attended was like that. And as I studied my Bible, though, I found this about churches like that. They worship in the flesh, they live in the flesh. Churches like that have all kind of fleshly problems because they're worshiping in the flesh. But here, this girl gets excited. Come back to it. It says, verse number 14, and when she knew Peter's voice, she opened not the gate for gladness. There's her excitement. But ran in and told how Peter stood before the gate. Now, again, excitement's good, but we should not let excitement control us. We let excitement be that encourages us along the way. And we need excitement along the way to encourage us from time to time. Isn't it nice to be able to laugh? I feel sorry for people that's always down in the mouth and old long face like a Missouri mule. I mean, I just don't understand that type of thing. We have the promises of God, but this girl here, she got so excited, she just ran off and left Peter standing at the door. But there's another thing about this girl. It says she was a maiden. That means that she was a young servant. She wasn't a daughter. This word means a servant. She was a hired servant or a young girl that family maybe had sold her into slavery for whatever reason. When my mom was a little girl, a lot of people, of course, it was right at the end of the Depression, and a lot of families back then, it wasn't what you call sell their kids, but they called it farming their kids out. And my mama was one that went to a neighbor family to work. One reason so she'd have enough food to eat. And so they wouldn't be more of a draw on the family. You have 12 kids, and that can cost a lot of money. And anyway, my mom was one of those that got farmed out as a servant girl. And here, she tells a tale about that. She said that the man was a little mean, and he got after her for not doing something like he wanted done. And my mama crawled up underneath the porch where he couldn't get to her. And she wouldn't come out. She told that man and the man's wife, she said, I will not come out till you get my mother. And her mama finally came, and mama told her that the guy was being mean and took my mama home. Anyway, it's funny. But this girl was in a position, now get this, the position she was in to know truth. She was in a house where praying was taking place. She was in a house where the gospel was known. She may have never heard the gospel if she hadn't been put in that position of being a servant. But have you ever stopped to think about the positions that you find yourself in sometime to hear the truth? I'm amazed when I look back over my life, the positions and the times that the Lord has allowed me to be around certain people, or the Lord's brought certain people across my path to teach me, to help me, to answer my questions. I mean, it's amazing to see how God works to make that. And here's a person of excitement, but a person that God had put in a place for blessing. I mean, this girl got blessed. She knew Peter, and she knew him well enough to recognize his voice. Let's move on. We see the problem of unbelief, verse number 15 and following. And they said unto her, thou art mad. Now that statement, there is an attack on Rhoda here. The word mad here literally means you're insane. It means you're crazy. As Barney would say, you're a nut. That's what they were saying to this girl. That shows their unbelief. Notice the second thing, her affirming confidence. Verse number 15 again. But she constantly affirmed. Literally means confidently. Firmly insisting or maintaining a confidence. This girl said, I know what I heard. Now, when we make statements like that, we should know what we're saying, right? And she did. But it shows unbelief on the people inside the house. Notice the third thing here. what I call the angel tradition. It is his angel. See, the Jews had a tradition that when a person died, their guardian angel would take that person's voice and form to inform loved ones of the death. Now, that's a tradition. Nowhere in Scripture do you find that taught. Sad to say, there's a whole lot of strange things that go on based on tradition. In the South, there's a tradition in many churches, not just independent Baptist churches, Southern Baptist churches have this, and I'm sure Free Will Baptist churches have this too, where you've got to jump up and down and scream and holler and run around to be full of the Spirit in a lot of places. Churches that I was raised in was like that. I mean, if you didn't shout and holler as the preacher, you weren't full of the Spirit. I think I've told the story here before, but let me tell it again. Renee and I were the first independent Baptist church we were in. I noticed that very strongly, that if you would shout and holler, you were viewed as being spiritual. And there's five preacher boys in the church. I was one of the five. The other four had got to preach. I hadn't got to preach yet. So I told Renee the night we were going to church, I said, I'm going to get to preach next week. She said, how do you know? Preacher asked you? I said, nobody's going to. She said, how do you know? I said, you just wait and see. And that morning in the choir, about halfway through the singing, I started shouting, running back and forth across the choir. And when I came down out of the choir, the pastor grabbed me by the arm right there. He said, oh, Frank, you got to preach. God's all over you, boy. That's a quote. That's exactly what he said to me. And I here I am thinking, if you knew what I just did. And of course, here I am thinking again. Obviously, you're not full of the Spirit of God, or you'd known I just tricked you. And I sit down beside Renee and I said, preaching Wednesday night. She said, how did you know? And of course, I didn't tell her what I did until we started home. The Spirit of God has nothing to do with motion. The Spirit of God has nothing to do with excitement. The Spirit of God has being full of the Spirit of God has everything to do with obedience and submission to the leadership of the Spirit of God. How loud you preach has nothing to do with the Spirit's fullness. Amen. Running back and forth has nothing to do with the Spirit's fullness. Is there content right from this book? Is this book being preached and clarified? Are you being challenged to live it? That has a whole lot more to do with the Spirit of God than the way it is delivered. But anyway, back to this. We see the tradition here was something that was false. And a tradition that's false will lead to more falseness. Let's move on. We see the angel tradition. The next thing we see in verse number 16 is the astonishment. But Peter continued knocking. And when they had opened the door and saw him, they were astonished. Again, these things show their unbelief. The word astonished here means amazed, confounded, or startled. When they saw him, they were startled. Now, what were they doing? They were praying that God would deliver Peter. And now when he's delivered, they're confounded. They're startled. One lesson that we need to learn from this, if we're going to pray, let's not be startled when God answers. I mean, that's what it's all about, is us to pray and for God to answer, for God to show himself mighty. And anyway, we see their astonishment. The next thing we see is the announcement of Peter, verse 17. But he, Peter, beckoning unto them with the hand to hold their peace. In other words, they were so startled and astonished that they were just running off at the mouth to each other. I mean, can you believe it? I mean, here's Peter. And they wouldn't even be quiet long enough to let Peter speak without him. I mean, he did something like that to let them know, hush, you know. Three things about his announcement. First, his declaration here in verse number 17. Declared unto them how the Lord had brought him out of the prison. Now, he gave them a count by count, play-by-play, if you will, on what took place. Do you think they listened when he started telling them, now this is what the angel of the Lord did. He kicked me in the side and woke me up. Then he, not only did he tell me to get up, he sort of helped jerk me up. Told me to put my clothes on, shoes on, we had to leave. And it was so bright in there. Remember the LED we talked about? The Lord's energetic display. I'm sure they listened with amazement. The second thing you see, not only his declaration, but his demand. He says, go show these things unto James. Now, James here is the pastor of the church at Jerusalem. He's the Lord's half-brother. And he says, go. An imperative. An urgent imperative. Why did Peter want James to know this? Well, first, James could call off the prayer meeting. You don't have to pray for Peter anymore. Peter's been released. The Lord miraculously. Would that be an encouragement to everybody that James sent that message to? Absolutely. Do you get excited when you hear about answered prayer? You should. Because when you see answered prayer, you're talking about a miraculous supernatural act. The third thing we see here is his departure. It says, and he departed and went into another place. Now, that another place is totally not known. I'm sure it was a place because, all right, he had been arrested. The King Herod wanted to cut his head off like he had James, John's brother James. And Peter, to be on the safe side, went somewhere where he'd be safe. He probably went somewhere that Herod would not be able to find. And, of course, we find out that Herod did not find him. So he went to a secretive place. And by the way, you need a secret place. And what I mean by that is a place to get along with God. We all need that place, a place where we can get along with God, a place where we're not interrupted, a place where you can turn your phone off and not feel guilty about it. I say that because it seems like nobody can stay without their phone, you know. It's funny, and I've said this before, but it is really funny for me as a preacher up here to watch when somebody's phone goes off in a service. I mean, it's just like... I mean, they get this look on their face like, oh, I can't stand who's calling me, what's what they're saying. And, I mean, they go through all kind of gyrations to try to get to that phone and look at it without you knowing they're doing it. It's really humorous sometimes. But anyway, that's right back to this. We see he went to another place. Now I want you to look, verse number 18 and 19, we go from the interrupted prayer meeting to the investigation of Herod. Now, as soon as it was day, there was no small stir among the soldiers what was become of Peter. First thing we see is the extreme anxiety of the soldiers. When it says no small stir, that means that is an interesting way of translating it because it means they were of great distress. It means they were extremely agitated. And the reason why they were extremely agitated, they knew to lose a prisoner meant death. I mean, that's what the Romans did. The Roman soldiers, if they lost somebody, they were going to be put to death. What did the Philippian jailer do? He was going to take a sword and he was going to fall on his own sword. And Paul hollered, hey, we're all here. And so he didn't. Of course, you're going over in what, chapter 26, 27, when Paul and him were on the ship, the centurion, one of the soldiers said, let's kill all of them lest they escape. And centurion wanting to save Paul said, no, we're not going to do that. So it was a practice. So you can understand their extreme anxiety. The second thing you see is the examination of the soldiers. And when Herod had sought for him and found him not, he examined the keepers and commanded that they should be put to death. What kind of questions do you think he asked? He said he sought Peter. That means to do an investigation. It means he searched every place he thought that Peter may be. But then he says he examined them. Not only do you see the investigation for Peter, but you see this word means to interrogate. Now, interrogate is a pretty strong word. It's not just the same as asking a question. Interrogate carries the idea of asking questions with pressure. Pressure to try to get somebody to, that wouldn't normally answer, trying to get them to answer your questions. What takes place when pressure is applied to questions and interrogations? What is used around the world that supposedly the American military doesn't use? Torture. Do you think Herod would mind torturing these soldiers to try to find out the truth? I guarantee he did. But sort of interesting, this word examined, it was a legal term in the Greek language, and it carries the idea of this interrogation would have been from a legal standpoint. See, Herod assumed they had helped free Peter. See, this is not the first time. Remember, we could go back to chapter 5 and verse number 19. Peter, the angel already released Peter one time. They couldn't find him. Now it's taking place again. So Herod here, it took place with the Sanhedrin before, and this time it's different. It's with the Herod, and he has the authority of the Roman government behind him, different than the religious temple guards of the Sanhedrin. But Herod, he would have known about that. And now he's saying, somebody's helping Peter. Now, of course, the supernatural was not a part of his thinking. May I say to all of us, as Christians, when it comes time for us to pray and we see God do something, let's give him glory. And let's not think that it was something that we did or something that man could do. But before I move on, this examination, may I say there is coming an examination for all of us? For us Christians, it's called the judgment seat of Christ. There will not be interrogation because he will already know everything that he has. And we will answer clearly and to the point. But that will not be. Paul said it struck terror in his heart there in 2 Corinthians chapter 5 to think about that time. And we should realize the time. Come back to this. We see the next thing, and that is the execution of the soldiers. He commanded that they be put to death. Now, it doesn't tell us how they were put to death. Rome used a number of ways. Of course, one of the ways they would have used would have Herod's already cut the head off of James, so he very well could have cut their head off. They did a lot of crucifixion. If they really wanted to humiliate the person, they would use the crucifixion. But nonetheless, he executed these soldiers. Now, here's a question, and I know this falls into the sovereignty of God, but why these four and not the other 12? Why the four that was the watch where he left? You ever thought about like that? And why Rhoda? Why did she get to be the one that got excited and hear the truth? Why these four soldiers? Why has God worked in your heart like he has? Sort of interesting to stop and realize God's working and God's mercy and God's punishment. But we see the investigation. Let's step into verse number 19 again and look this time at the pride of Herod. Verse number 19, last part. And he went down from Judah to Caesarea and there abode. The first thing I want you to see about the pride of Herod is what I call the escape from failure. Herod had two main places he stayed. One was in Jerusalem. The second one was in Caesarea. Caesarea was the governmental capital. I've been to Caesarea. It's quite interesting to see what's still there and then try to imagine what it looked like. And there's pictures there. If you ever go to Israel and go to Caesarea, you'll see the governmental buildings. And then there's pictures there of what it looked like when it was built. Quite impressive. I mean, there is a what we would call a theater, a round high rock step up where people would sit, and there'd be a stage down below. By the way, that's where Paul gave a defense to Felix and Festus. There is an amphitheater type setting where they had horse races, or people could run. And I remember when we were there, a bunch of the guys lined up and ran down the area. There was a swimming pool built right beside the ocean. The waves lapped up right on the edge of the swimming pool down beside the Mediterranean Sea. The man-made docks where they would bring their boats in. Big fancy palace with, you know, their bathhouses. I mean, the Romans knew how to build things. And Herod here, that was where he went, and he went there to escape his failure. You say his failure? Yeah, he failed to kill Peter. That was his goal. He failed to please the Jews. That's what he wanted to kill Peter for, so he could please the Jews to keep the Jews on his side. And he failed in all that. And he went there to escape their criticism. The Jews were known to the Roman government to have been pesty. I mean, they complained about everything. I mean, they were not satisfied with hardly anything the Romans did. But anyway, he escaped there. Now, Caesarea is roughly 60 miles north and west of Jerusalem. Again, an unbelievable seaside palace. The second thing we see is what I call the exceeding displeasure with Tyre and Sidon. Notice what he says in verse 20. And Herod was highly displeased. That means extremely so. It means to be furious. Now, it does not tell us in this context what he was mad about. It just tells us that he was greatly angry. Now, I'm sure, and remember we talked about the Herod family last time, it did not take much with any of the Herods to make them mad. I mean, they had a very short fuse to start with. But whatever they did, we do not know, but it just says he was exceedingly mad. And Tyre and Sidon was roughly 80 miles north of Caesarea in what is present day called Lebanon. In that day, it would have been part of what is called Phoenicia. But he was exceedingly mad. Now, here's a principle that we can draw from that. We need to learn to control our temper. Matter yet, we should just give our temper to the Lord. I mean, Ephesians chapter number 4, verse 30 down through verse number 32 tells us to put away anger. It's a command. Put it away. Wrath, clamor, everything associated with anger, we're to put it away. That's a choice of our will. And I say that because I've had, I don't know how many people throughout my ministry, Pastor Camp, I just can't do this. And I look and I said, you don't want to. Because the Bible tells you that you can. It's a choice. You choose to put it away. Put it away from you. You know, one way, the best way, other than that obedience, you fill your heart with the love of Christ, and I promise you, your anger will become less and less and less and less as you fill your heart with the love of Christ. Anyway, that's really bad to this. Third thing we see in verse number 20 is what I call the expedient arrangement. Notice the last part of verse number 20. But they came, that's the people, the leadership of Tyre and Sidon, but they came with one accord to him, and having made Blastus, the king's chamberman, their friend, desired peace. Now, the first thing I want you to see in this expedient arrangement is what I call the politicking. You know, really, politics haven't changed in over 2,000 years. The principles of politics are still the same. You do what you need to do to get what you want. That's what politics does. Now, there's nothing in that that talks about character. Nothing, because for them to come down with one accord, I promise you, there was compromise involved on somebody's part. They were willing to compromise really what they believed or what they stood for that was causing the issue in order for them to get what they wanted out of this. The Bible teaches that we're supposed to let our yea be yea and our nay be nay. If it's biblical, we stand there. If everybody else is against us, or if everybody else is for us, if it's biblical, if it's right, you stand there. You don't compromise. You don't politic over it. You don't try to get somebody else to do something with an ulterior motive. Anyway, there's a lot I could say about that, but they came with one accord. They made friends with Blastus. Now, I wonder how they did that. In politic and realm, there's usually promises made or bribes given for somebody that's not your friend to become your friend in the politic and world. But anyway, there's a lot more I could say. The second thing you see here is the peace salt. It says they desired peace. Now, that's a really smart move on their part. The reason? Herod had the army on his side. They didn't have an army on their side. And very few people rebelled against Roman rule, Roman authority, with much success. If they did, it was a temporary success usually. That's one thing about the Romans in Israel. I mean, they defeated Israel more than once. Titus came and surrounded the city in 70 AD, killed over 1 million Jews. And then after that, the Jews in their ongoing rebellion established themselves on top of a mountain called Masada. And there's only 200 and something of them up there. But Rome spent months building a causeway, I mean, bringing in thousands and millions of pounds and probably millions of tons of dirt to lay in. All right, here's the mountain. They built a causeway up so they could roll a ram up and bust a hole through the wall to get in to get those Jews. I mean, there's not many armies in the world that would have concerned themselves with such a small number of people to spend that kind of time and money to get to them, but that's wrong. But these people were pretty smart in this peace salt. But the third thing you see is what I call the provision desired. It says, because their country was nourished by the king's country, or by literally by the king. Notice the country is in italics. What does that mean? The word nourished literally means to provide food. They were concerned about their food. Notice next verse, verse number 21, what I call the exhibition of pride. Verse 21. And upon a set day, Herod, arrayed in royal apparel, sat upon his throne and made an oration unto them. First thing you see is what I call the day. It was not just any day, it was a set day. And this idea is that it was determined, that it was appointed, it was planned. Herod planned this day. He probably sent his envoys up to Sidon and Tyre and said, all right, it's time that we settle this. You send your representatives down, we're going to settle this. So it shows a whole lot of planning. Now, Josephus tells us that this was on a special day, a day that was set aside as a festival unto Claudius Caesar. So that word set day refers to that type of idea. The second thing we see is what I call the display. And the display was in more than one way. Notice it says that he arrayed in royal apparel. So the first thing we see is his display was in his clothes. Royal apparel. Now, again, I refer to Josephus because Josephus, in his history, by the way, Josephus was a Jewish historian that was commissioned and paid by the Roman government to write a history of the Jews. Anyway, he says that he describes this royal apparel as being almost totally made out of silver thread. And that when he came out on this day, he came out in the morning as the sun was rising and waited for the sun to hit his clothes, and it made him glow. And it was done on purpose, for effect. So we see his display, first of all, in his apparel. Secondly, we see his display was from his authority. He says, and set upon his throne. Now, what is so, to me, this was very interesting because the Greek language, there is a word that all through Revelation, the word throne is used. And this is the word, the Greek word, thronos, is the Greek word that's translated throne, not here. The Greek word that's used right here, get this, you hear it? Bema. It's the place of judgment. That was the Bema seat. That's where the judge would sit behind when he's making his judgment. That's the Greek word used right here. It's translated throne. It's quite interesting. And it speaks of his authority. He was displaying his authority. Some people like to parade their authority. I've been around more than one. I've worked for more than one person that's made this statement. Well, I'm the boss. Well, I already knew that. He didn't have to remind me of that, but they reminded everybody that of their authority, like that was going to make a difference in what you did. And here, that's what he's doing. So we see his display. Thirdly, we see his delivery. It says, and made an oration unto them. Now, this oratory, this idea means to deliver a public speech. Now, he planned this. Do you think he practiced his speech? Do you think he wrote it, or did he have one of his speech writers? I mean, I find that interesting that all these people have speech writers, you know? I just believe if I were in public office that I would want to write my own speech. I wouldn't want somebody else putting words in my mouth. But it was apparently a great speech. There's been a number of them, by the way, in history. I've commented on this before. Adolf Hitler is one of the greatest orators that's ever lived. Oh, by the way, the Antichrist will be a great orator too. I mean, they will be able to sway people's thinking, be able to sway people's emotions. And by the way, I am not a preacher that wants to sway your emotions. I think you've figured that out about me by now. I don't want to sway your emotions. I do not want you making a decision based on your emotions. I want you to make a decision based on the truth of this book and submission to the conviction of the Spirit of God that works in your life. If you will not make a decision based on those things, nothing I get you to try to maybe push you or prod you is going to be of any eternal value. But here he had this delivery, and it affected these people greatly. The next thing I want you to see is what I call the deceptive praise, verse 20. And the people gave a shout, saying, it is the voice of a God and not of a man. Now this shout it was a continuous tense. It wasn't that they just gave it one time. It was an ongoing thing that they did. A continuous action in this time. And it means they were crying out very loudly this. It wasn't they were just talking among themselves. They were screaming this top of their voice. And the next thing I want you to see, other than the exhibition of pride, is what I call the execution of punishment. Notice verse 23. And immediately. Now, between the time these people started saying this, being that was a continuous action verb, there was a length of time from that to the time that the angel struck him. How long, I don't know. But it was long enough. God gave him long enough that he could have quieted the crowd and says, don't give me that praise. It says, and immediately the angel of the Lord smote him. Notice the reason. Because he gave not God the glory. The first thing we see in this execution of punishment is the sudden death. The word smote means to strike down, to slay, to strike dead. Now, obviously through the process at this point right here, he didn't die. It was a process. But death was in the sentence. Again, I refer to Josephus. Josephus says that he was immediately struck with violent abdomen pain. So they had to carry him into the palace, and after 5 days of suffering, he finally died. That's what Josephus says. But anyway, here we see the sudden death. The second thing you see is what I call the sovereign authority. It's the angel of the Lord. And by the way, this is not the only place. You could go to 2 Samuel chapter 24 and verse number 16. There you see the angel of the Lord. God said, as the angel of the Lord is getting ready to slay people of the city, he said, nope, that's enough, stop. Of course, we find another place where one angel killed 185,000 Syrians in one night. And in the book of Revelation, of course, you find angels that were involved in all the plagues and the judgments of the book of Revelation. Angels are powerful beings, and we just are oblivious to the reality of them. But it was the sovereign act of God. It was the angel of the Lord smote him. The Lord sent him to take care of this. The third thing that I want us to see is what I call the stolen glory. And it says here, because he gave not God the glory. I challenge you for the sake of time, I won't go there, but go sometime to Isaiah chapter 42 and verse number 8. It says, God says there, I will not share my glory with a man, another man, another person. It's not going to take place. At least 29 times in Scripture, it tells us to fear God and give glory to Him. It's said in a similar way, but at least 29 times it makes a reference to the fact that we need to give God glory. And we as people should never make this statement, I've got this. That's robbing God of His glory. Again, you know, Pharaoh had to learn this in the book of Exodus. Nebuchadnezzar had to learn it in the book of Daniel. And there's a whole lot of others all throughout the Bible that's had to learn the lesson. I need to give God glory. But notice, lastly, the shameful end. Verse, back to this. And he was eaten of worms and gave up the ghost. Now, that's just a gruesome type of way to die. And you can do some research on this, but it is very possible for there to be an infestation of worms in your intestines. But this, let me say this before, this is not a natural death. This is a supernatural death. This was a death of punishment. And when God chooses to bring punishment, again, in the book of Revelation, the deaths were not pretty. And we don't, God would do that? God gets to the place where sin makes him sick and sin makes him angry. Now, for us, his wrath for my sin was poured out upon Jesus Christ. And because that Christ suffered my punishment, the anger that God would have toward me has been appeased. That's called propitiation. His blood propitiated my sin before God. He's no longer. Get this now. Don't have a wrong view of God. He is, if you know Christ, He's not angry with you. You have been made at peace, Romans chapter 5. We have we are peace with God, and we should have the peace of God. And then we're not going to come to a shameful end. Father, we thank you tonight for your blessings upon us, your goodness to us. Bless us in our prayer time, I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.